I would like to extend a very special welcome to members of the Ancient Order of Hibernians and Ladies Ancient Order of Hibernians who are with us today. In 1978, the Ancient Order of Hibernians established an endowment at the Cushwa Center to support the study of Irish America. So for almost four decades now, this fund has enabled the Cushwa Center to promote the study of Irish and Irish American history and culture in various ways. We offer research awards each year to support publication projects in the field. We regularly sponsor and host a variety of conferences and fellowships relating to Irish American history and increasingly global Irish Catholic history. But the annual Hibernian Lecture has long been the centerpiece of Cushwa's commitment in this area. It's our big event of the year, and I'm so very pleased to welcome Thomas Lynch as our lecturer for this afternoon. Mr. Lynch is a writer, poet, and funeral director. He's the author of five collections of poems and four books of essays. His writing draws deeply from two primary sources of inspiration, his work as an undertaker and his Irish roots. Mr. Lynch has worked as a funeral director in Milford, Michigan since 1974. And since 1970, he has also made yearly visits to family and friends in Ireland, and he spends a portion of each year in County Clare, Ireland, where he keeps an ancestral cottage. These experiences provide the context for much of his writing. His first book of poems, Skating with Heather Grace, was published in 1987 and was reissued in 2011 by Carnegie Mellon University Press in their Classic Contemporary series. He was a finalist for the National Book Award and won the Heartland Prize and the American Book Award for his 1977 collection of essays, The Undertaking, Life Studies from the Dismal Trade. That book and the Lynch family's work in Milford, Michigan, were the subject of PBS's Frontline 2007 documentary, The Undertaking, which won the 2008 Emmy Award for Arts and Culture Documentary. In 2005, Lynch published Booking Passage, We Irish and Americans, a memoir exploring the history and culture of Ireland and the ways that American descendants of the diaspora both relate to and forget their roots. In a review published in Commonweal magazine, Gregory Wolfe described the scene in the book where Lynch is talking about his brother's reaction to his cousin Nora's funeral. Lynch describes his brother's sudden meltdown into sobs and tears. "Oh God," Pat said, "to think of it, Tom, the truth and beauty of it." Booking Passage, he goes on to say, does full justice to the truth and beauty of it. The it, of course, defies summary. It was the death of a simple, good woman, to be sure, but also the history and culture of Ireland and the way American descendants of the diaspora relate to and forget their roots. It is a particular way of relating to language, embracing poetry and liturgy, anecdote and gossip, the sprightly music of jigs and reels, and the tragic fatalism of ballads, the echoes of a pre-technological culture growing fainter as the Ireland of famine and troubles gives way to the economic powerhouse now known as the Celtic Tiger, where the ratio between pubs and wine bars is changing rapidly. Mr. Lynch has taught with the graduate program in writing at the University of Michigan, the Department of Mortuary Science at Wayne State University, and the Candler School of Theology at Emory University. He has received grants and awards from the National Endowment for the Arts, the Michigan Council for the Arts, the Michigan Library Association, the Writer's Voice Project, the National Book Foundation, and the Arts Council of Ireland. His writing has been featured in the New York Times and Times of London, Harper's, Newsweek, The New Yorker, and the Paris Review. In 2011, Paraclete Press published a book of Lynch's poems called The Sin Eater, a breviary. You do have the best titles, I have to say. This evening, Mr. Lynch joins us to reflect on the poetry and recent deaths of Seamus Heaney and Dennis O'Driscoll. For anyone who's interested, please note that the Notre Dame bookstore has copies of many of these books on display and for sale today and throughout the weekend. Shouldn't get too crowded at the bookstore. You can fight your way in to get these books. And with that helpful plug, please join me now in welcoming Thomas Lynch.
Well, my goodness. I want to thank Kathleen and Peter, both of whom are attached to the Cushwa Center, for the invitation to return to Notre Dame, and to the Ancient Order of Hibernians, among whose members I have spent many a happy evening until I had to give up drink years ago, and I took up solitary prayer. But I'm glad that so many of you came today. It's nice for any poet to be outnumbered. We always say that wherever we are outnumbered and then possibly outweighed, it's a great success. And to be outnumbered by dozens is obituary class when it happens at Notre Dame. So thank you very, very much. And I thought, coming into town, I thought, my golly, they do some promotion for this, for these events at the Cushwa Center. And then I heard there was a football game. And I recall that I first, I think, started coming to South Bend when they were building what I think some scallywag calls Touchdown Jesus in the library when I was a boy. A friend of mine, his name was Hogan, was in love with a woman whose father worked well. That's another story. I was raised in a culture, but Kathleen, really, that was encyclopedic, tastefully hyperbolic, and vaguely obituarial, the way you covered all those titles. So if you will send me a copy of that, I'll throw it in a file back home. And I mean my thanks genuinely. It's very good to be here. I feel I should add to such kind introductions the fact that I was raised in a culture like I assume many of you were, where the men were expected to grow up to become priests or alcoholics, and I feel I should always add to the intro that my name is Tom and I am not a priest. I'm a funeral director and a poet, which is to say the mortuary and the literary equivalent of a proctologist with a sideline and root canal. A hyphenated dual purpose, if not exactly appreciated, amalgam of the pain in the ass and the throbbing molar, heartbreak and near coma. So thank you for turning out today. And if you nod and smile, I'll think you're swooning. If your eyes close, I'll think you're meditating. And if you don't snore, everything will go fine. But if you do, we might have you removed, which in my line of work is serious. So let us contemplate for a while the first things and the last things, where we come from, how we come to be here, where we might be going next. As that great agnostic Robert Ingersoll observed at the graveside of a child he was called upon to bury years ago, every cradle asks us whence, and every coffin whither. And isn't it just so? What's on either end of those contraptions? I've always had an interest all my life in the cradle and the coffin trade, or as the Irish master Yeats said in a letter once to Olivia Shakespeare, who we should say he was trying to chat up, the only subjects worthy of our contemplation are sex and the dead. How happy for me, I thought, when I first read that, because I approved of sex. I was enthusiastic about it. And the dead were everywhere. The horizontal mysteries, the breathless, tearful, and variously wonderful marvels of the human body. In the first poem of his first book, Death of a Naturalist, published now 50 years ago this year, the late, great Seamus Heaney, who read here at Notre Dame, I think, 13 years ago. The poet talks about the difference between the shovel and the shoulder work of Irish labor and the scriptural, in the Latin sense of scriptura, the writerly work of Irish literature, on which he would have such a profound and permanent impact. And he was joined in this by Seamus Dean, I think a member of this faculty for years and years. They were classmates and forever changed the glacier of Irish letters. Let me say this poem that everyone likely knows by heart but me, but I heard it so many times that I thought, I'll hear it again and again, and I was shocked, actually, some 3 years ago now when the voice of its maker went still, digging. Between my finger and my thumb, the squat pen rests, snug as a gun. Under my window, a clean rasping sound when the spade sinks into gravelly ground, my father digging. I look down, till his straining rump among the flower beds bends low, comes up 20 years ago, stooping in rhythm through potato drills where he was digging. The coarse boot nestled on the lug, the shaft against the inside knee was levered firmly. He rooted out tall tops, buried the bright edge deep to scatter new potatoes that we picked, loving their cool hardness in our hands. By God, that old man could handle a spade just like his old man. My grandfather cut more turf in a day than any other man on Toner's Bog. Once I carried him milk in a bottle, corked sloppily with paper. He straightened up to drink it, fell to right away, nicking and slicing neatly, heaving sods over his shoulder, going down and down for the good turf, digging. The cold smell of potato mold, the squelch and slap of soggy peat, the curt cuts of an edge through living roots awaken in my head. But I've no spade to follow men like them. Between my finger and my thumb, the squat pen rests. I'll dig with it. So this first poem in this first book, this unambiguous artistic manifesto, equates the writerly work he intends to do with the manful labor, the shoulder and shovel work of, in this case, digging a flower bed underneath the window. As with poetry, it is the hearing that happens first, the spade being sunk in the gravel, the pea gravel of the garden. All the senses follow. His work in words, like his father's work in the garden and the field, will feed and fuel and warm and nurture and illuminate for half a century to come. I was 21 when I first heard that. It was February of 1970, and I was on my first visit to Ireland. I got a high number in the Nixon draft lotto. Some of you will remember that. It was drawn in December of 1969, and number 254 assured that I would not be going to be fodder for that particular war. As a lackluster university student without much thought for the bright future, I thought, maybe I'll go to Ireland to bask in the poetry of Yeats and Kavanagh, the fiction of Joyce. It was my grandfather's praying that put that into my brain box. As was his wont over Sunday dinners, he would add to whatever the grace he said before meals this directive: and don't forget your cousins, Tommy and Nora, on the banks of the River Shannon. He never met Tommy and Nora. He didn't know the River Shannon from the St. Joe River. He wouldn't know the banks of it from a Buick. But he was told by his father, who had come from West Clare some years before, never to forget the home place and the two cousins left who took care of it. I was the first one to get their address, that strange numberless address, Moveen West, Kilkee, County Clare, Ireland, and write to them in December of 69 and suggest a visit three generations late of one of the returning Lynches. I was the grandson of their first cousin, and I was the namesake of their dead priest, the first cousin. So while I am not a priest, I was named for one. I suppose it was hopeful. It didn't stick. In the summer of 2012, Gus Nichols, one of Dublin's great undertakers and the president of the International Federation of Thanatological Associations, aren't we good at names? The same crowd. It's Dan, Tom, Pat, Tim, Bridget, Mary, Joe, and John, all the way down the generations. But when it comes to making something out of nothing, let me suggest that the International Federation of Thanatological Associations is a great bunch of gobs. It's a congress of funeral directors from around the world, and at their 12th international conference, they would have representatives from 30 nations. 250 registrants in all, from places as far-flung as Malaysia and Sierra Leone and Argentina, Australia, China, and Colombia. My brother Pat was the immediate past president of our own National Funeral Directors Association and traveled with me as a delegate from the United States to thank Gus Nichols and Finbar O'Connor and other funeral directors we knew from the Irish Association for having traveled to Chicago to see Pat's installation the year before. There was going to be a gala banquet and a golf outing and a tour of Glasnevin Cemetery and the Titanic exhibit up in Belfast, and good shopping on Grafton Street was promised. The conference was held in Dublin Castle, a huge walled compound in the center of that ancient city, with turrets and towers, dungeons and courtyards dating to the early 13th century. 800 years of history oozing from its old stones, and I found myself constructing a line for that obituary file I'm always editing in my head, which would someday in the long distant future read, "He had presented to funeral directors from around the world. Travel and castles will do that to you." I was grateful for that invitation. I'd been to the castle before, actually. I'd been to Ireland dozens of times in the nearly 50 years since my first visit there in the winter of 1970. But my first visit to Dublin Castle was in the 1980s to the offices of Poetry Ireland. It will give you some sense of how the Irish regard poetry, that they keep it in a castle locked up. 25 years and several books after that, rising to speak to a group of funeral directors from Asia and Africa, it seemed as if my life's work and preoccupations had somehow finally wound themselves together, poetry and funerals, the literary and the mortuary arts, finally melding into one. I was going to read them some poems, and they were going to pay me. They were in many ways the same but different, poetry and funerals, equal tributaries of one enterprise, so much so that, in fact, I titled my presentation on the day after a poem called Local Heroes, which I regard funeral directors to be in some places. It felt like a gift, and I felt exceptionally gifted to be there, to consider in front of all those people, just like all these people, how is it we come to be the ones we are? I was raised by Irish Catholics. Even when I say that now, it sounds like wolves, or some especially feral class of creature. Not in the apish, nativist sense of immigrant hordes, rather in the faith and family loyalties, the fierceness that attends both, the pack dynamics, their clannishness, their vigilance and pride. My parents were grandchildren of immigrants who had mostly married within the tribe. They'd sailed from 19th century poverty into the prospects of North America, from West Clare and Tipperary, Sligo and Kilkenny, to Montreal and Ontario, upper and lower Michigan. Graces and O'Haras, Ryans and Lynches, they brought their version of the one true faith, druidic and priest-ridden, punctilious and full of superstitions, from the boggy parishes of their ancients to the fertile expanse of Middle America. These were people who saw statues move, truths about the weather and the way a cat turned her back to the fire, omens about coming contentions in a pair of shoes left up on a table, bad luck in some numbers, good fortune in others, odd lights in the nightscape foreshadowed death, dog's eyes attracted lightning, the curse of an old woman could lay one low. The clergy were given what's going to them, but otherwise not to be tampered with. Priests were feared, and their favor was curried, their curses and blessings opposing poles of the powerful medicine they were known to possess. Everything had meaning beyond the obvious. The dead were everywhere, and their ghosts inhabited the air and memory, and their old haunts real as ever, if only slightly former tensed, in constant need of care and appeasement. They were, like the saints they'd been named for, prayed over, prayed to, invoked as protection against all enemies, their names recycled through generations, reassigned to new incarnations. My mother thought I might become a priest, not because I was especially holy, rather As a devout and Catholic mother of six sons and, in the fullness of time, three daughters, she would have known the expected ecclesiastical surtax on so many healthy babies would have been maybe a curate or two and maybe a nun to boot. "Be stingy with the Lord," she would often tell us, quoting Father Kenny, her parish priest and confessor. "Be stingy with the Lord, and the Lord will be stingy with you." Father Thomas Kenny was from Threadneedle Road in Salt Hill, a place to which he repaired after Vatican II for reasons that can only be known to him. I was named for one of his classmates, a dead priest who was my father's uncle. Some few years after surviving the Spanish flu early in the last century, he got the call. "Vocations follow famine," an old bromide holds in Clare, no less the flu. He went to seminary in Detroit and Denver, was ordained in the middle of the Great Depression. We have a photo of his first solemn high mass on June the 10th, 1934, at St. John's Church in Jackson, Michigan, a nine iron's drive from here, a block from the clapboard house he grew up in. His father, Thomas Curry Lynch, my namesake, did not live to get his photo taken with the priest. These women in print dresses and men in straw boaters on a sunny June day between world wars. He had come from the poor townland of Moveen in West Clare that forms the upper lip of the gaping mouth of the River Shannon, a treeless, sloping plain between the ocean and the estuary, its plots and pasturage divided by hedgerows of intermarriages. He'd come to Michigan for the work available at the huge penitentiary there in Jackson, where he painted cell blocks, worked in the laundry, did some janitorial work, and finished his career as a uniformed guard. He married Ellen Ryan on the way over, herself an immigrant. Together they raised a daughter who taught, a son who got good work with the post office, and another who would become a priest. It was like hitting the trifecta for poor immigrant Irish. All cushy Yankee jobs with white collars and reliable pensions. He never saw Ireland again, nor did his son or his son's son. In the middle of the retinue of family and parishioners posed for a photo at the doors of the church, the freshly minted homegrown priest, just below him, there on the chair next to his father in the knee breeches and saddle shoes, is my father. He's 10 years old. He hasn't yet met the girl of his dreams. Maybe they're figuring he'll be a priest. Because the young priest in the picture is sickly, having survived the flu those years before, his bishop sends him for his final training to Denver, and then after this picture is taken, he's shipped off to Taos, New Mexico to treat the Native American population there. And he spends 2 years avoiding contagions and other problems, but sooner or later he gets pneumonia and he dies. And the Apache women board him up in a box and put him on a buckboard and take him down the headwaters of the Rio Grande and present him in the cathedral of the one true faith in Santa Fe. St. Francis, I think they named it. The bishop, I think his name was Gherkin, did the needful requiems, then put him on a train bound east, collect, as bishops do. Where he was consigned to the Denoyer Funeral Home in Jackson, Michigan. They met the train, and the next day met my grandfather, the priest's next of kin, who, for reasons we don't quite know why, he took his now 12-year-old son in to make the arrangements with him. And as the men spoke about requiems and mum plants and stipendiums, my father wandered through the old house that was and remains the Denoyer Funeral Home, until he came to a room, the door ajar, where two men in white shirts, striped ties, striped trousers, and braces, I think they call them in your country, Paul, were vesting the priest in liturgical garb. And at a certain time, without any talk or signal, they reached beneath the now clothed corpse, rolled the body towards them, steadied themselves with a bend of the knees, and sidestepped their way over to the box on the wall and carefully lay him in the coffin. And it is to this moment that my father will ever after assign the decision he would make on the day to become a funeral director. Why, we would often ask him as he wound out the narrative, why, Eddie, we called him Eddie by this point, why didn't you want to be a priest? Ah, he said, the priest was dead. He was not given to metaphor. He was the grandson of West Clare people and said what he thought to be the truth of it. It was also true that he had met that year Rosemary O'Hara, a red-headed fifth grader with shapely ankles and other attributes, who would become the girl of his dreams. She would write him daily through the war in the South Pacific, her letters being lost to the mud and of that war and trouble. His letters still in our possession. My darling Rose, all my love, always. Across the decades, across the century, long past their deaths, they still talk to one another from their perches in our cloud of witnesses. God works in strange ways, my mother would remind us, passing out the spuds, all of us marveling at the ways of things. These callings, such as they are, these summonses to her life as a wife and mother, and to his as a father and undertaker, a life's work he would always describe as serving the living by caring for the dead, or as a corporal work of mercy, or not just a living, but a way of life. And his sons and daughters and their sons and daughters, who operate now, I think, half a dozen or eight funeral homes all over southeastern lower Michigan, all tied to that first week of August in 1936, and to a boy watching two men lift the body of a dead priest into a box. Listen to your life, the writer and churchman Frederick Buechner tells us. See it for the fathomless mystery it is. Fred Buechner is a Presbyterian, turned 90 this year. Not Presbyterian in the way that Donald Trump is a Presbyterian. But as they would say in Clare, ah, the same, but different. By 20, I was happily apostate, having come into my disbelief some few years after puberty when a fellow pilgrim showed me all that she could on the exquisite mysteries of life. If the nuns had been wrong about sex, and they were, it followed, I reasoned, they could be wrong about other things. Why do you reason about these things in your heart? Jesus asks the naysaying elders in Capernaum in Mark's telling of the healing of a paralytic. They are trying to catch his blaspheming out in the way that we are always conniving against our spiritual betters. It's a story that works its way through Heaney's later poetry, beginning with its appearance in Seeing Things, where after insisting on a skylight in the attic room where he writes, his wife gets him to write a sonnet to her better design. Think, let me see if I can find that. I'd like to give you a taste of the great man's poetry. I thought I had a book of his. I do. Thanks be. The skylight. This, by the way, once you've heard a couple of these poems, you can tell your teenage children or grandchildren when you go back that among the other things you did on this weekend was you attended a poetry reading. This will make them fear you in ways they don't currently. So I say go ahead and use it for everything it's worth. the skylight. You were the one for skylights. I posed, cutting into the seasoned tongue and groove of pitch pine. I liked it low and closed, its claustrophobic nest up in the roof effect. I like the snuff-dry feeling, the perfect trunk-lid fit of the old ceiling. Under there, it was all hutch and hatch. The blue slates kept the heat like midnight thatch. But when the slates came off, extravagant sky entered and held surprise wide open. For days, I felt like an inhabitant of that house where the man, sick of the palsy, was lowered through the roof, his sins forgiven, was healed, took up his bed, and walked away. So it was a shock to me, after I had gone about my father's business, to be put in earshot of poetry that actually spoke to the predicament I often found myself in over paralytic or disabled bodies, over corpses. And I found that some of the best preaching comes on when there's a breathless body on the premises. The book of Job, however god-awful and comfortless it is, remained for me a testament of faith. Blessed be the name of the Lord, whoever she is. Nonetheless, I remained devoutly lapsed in my confession and praxis. So I was shocked years later when a fellow Rotarian called to ask me if I would join their Bible study. "We're looking for a good Catholic to join up," he said. "Let me know if you find one," said I in response. We laughed. It was going to meet at 6:30 every Tuesday morning in a local eatery, now defunct, and I thought to myself, it can't go long. Crummy food, crummy hour, only a good book, not a great one, like Cocker Spaniels, you know. I can't remember not knowing about the healing of the paralytic, whether I heard it at Mass or from one of the nuns or Christian brothers who were in charge of my education, or I read it in the Bible study. I don't know, but there it is. Three Gospels out of four, the details more or less the same. It's one of the three dozen miracle stories that punctuate the New Testament, from changing water into wine at Cana, calming the storm and filling the fish nets, to healing lepers and the blind and lame and raising the dead, which got him into trouble. There were endless demons and devils cast out, sins forgiven, apparitions after his death. It was a poem in a book published a few years back that brought it newly to life for me. The last time I heard Seamus read was in the Glenn Memorial Chapel at Emory University. It's the remains of a Methodist church, which doubles as an auditorium for larger gatherings. It was the 2nd of March, 2013. I was occupying the McDonald chair, a cushy sinecure with the Candler School, teaching a course with the theologian Tom Long on the poetics of the sermon. Dr. Long and I were just putting the finishing touches on a book called The Good Funeral, due out later that year. And I was learning words like exegesis and hermeneutics and studying the dynamics of fiction, which Dr. Long regarded as a workable template for homiletics. We examined narrative arc and point of view, plot and character and setting. We read poems and short fictions and published sermons. I was so glad that Heaney was coming to town. He had been the most amplified and ever-present voice of my generation of poets. His work, since I first encountered it in County Clare, has never failed to return a rich trove of metaphoric treasure and word hoard. Because his poetry came so much from a Catholic upbringing in rural Ireland, he became a useful guide for me through the parish of language and imagination. Possibly because I first encountered poetry as prayer, or at least as language cast in rhyme and meter, addressed to the heavens as a sort of raised speech, poetry has always seemed sacred to me, proper for addressing the happenstance in creation. Heaney held the natural world in similar thrall. The chore and toil of the mundane, earthbound and near to hand, he had awe and reverence for every sort of work. Still, the Latin I'd learned as an altar boy in the 1950s, the sacraments, devotions, and sensibilities I'd been raised with found so many echoes in the early poems of Heaney and in my own that the experience seemed to deserve further examination. Though freighted with doubts and wonders and religiously adrift, I treasured the language of faith as an outright gift. The hymns of the Wesley brothers, the angel wrestling contemplations of John Calvin and John Knox, the exile and anchoritic adventures of Columbkeel, and the rubrics of holy women and men, I retained some level of religious literacy given me by the nuns and brothers, but rejected the magisterium of the church. By the time I arrived at Emory in the late winter of 2013, I was deeply devoted to a church of Latter-day poets, skeptics and non-compliant but curious sorts. The irony of such a backslidden fellow as myself teaching at a school of theology named for a Methodist bishop and the brother of the owner of our national sugar water, Coca-Cola, was not lost on me. Though I had been schooled in my apostasy by some of the greats and by the malfeasance of bishops and abusive priests, I had also witnessed over 40 years in funeral service the everyday heroics of the reverend clergy and their co-religionists. These were men and women of faith who showed up whenever there was trouble. Their best preaching was done when the chips were down, in extremis, at deathbeds, in hospitals and nursing homes and family homes and funeral homes. And I'd been schooled in my semester among the Methodists at Emory and by my friendship with Thomas Long, whose scholarship in work and words has reformed me in ways I thought impossible. Thus, Heaney's reading from the raised chapel of Glen Memorial seemed like a keeping holy of the Sabbath. And when he said, deep into what would become one of his last public readings, that he'd like to read some poems from his last book, and then caught himself to say, I mean my most recent collection, I thought, the insertion of that shadow of death, a deft touch by a seasoned performer. It is also true that his most recent collection, Human Chain, became a haunted book dogged by death and impendency and his last. He read what turns out to be one of my favorite poems. Miracle proposes a shift in focus from the scriptural story of Jesus healing the paralytic, my favorite rendition in Mark chapter 2. Jesus is preaching in Capernaum, and the crowd is so great they've filled the room and spilled out of the door into the street, so much so that the four men charged with bringing the paralytic for his healing have to hoist him up to the roof, where they remove the roof tiles or dig through the sods and lower him down on his bed by ropes, whereupon Jesus, impressed by their faith, tells the poor cripple his sins are forgiven. Of course, the begrudgers among them, and there are always begrudgers, begin to mumble among themselves about blasphemy, because who can forgive sin but God? Jesus, because he's Jesus, begins to question them, asking them about which is the greater or the lesser miracle, to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, arise, take up your bed and walk. It is, of course, a trick question, like most of the red parts of the Bible, because forgiveness seems so impossible most days, whether to give it or to receive, impossible to see. It would always take a miracle. Who among us has not withered and weighed down by the accrual of actual or imagined slights, betrayals, resentments, estrangements, and bad deeds done us by someone we truly loved? And in ways I needn't number, aren't we all paralyzed, hobbled by our grievances and heartbreaks, by the press of sin, the failure of vision, by fear and worry, anxieties about the end? Whereas the scripture directs our attention to the paralytic and to the quibbles between Jesus and the scribes, Heaney's poem bids us be mindful of the less learned toil and utterly miraculous decency of the ones who had known him all along, the ones who know us all along, who lift us up, bear us on our way in our brokenness, and get us where we need to go. On any given day, it seems like miracle enough. And aren't corpses the most paralyzed, the most disabled, the most in need of someone to get them where they need to go and route to getting where the living need to be? Maybe that's what my father saw when that poor dead priest was lifted, the heavy lift of putting that dead boy into his box. Here's the short poem, Miracle. Not the one who takes up his bed and walks, but the ones who have known him all along and carry him in. Their shoulders numb, the ache and stoop deep locked in their backs, the stretcher handles slippery with sweat and no let up until he's strapped on tight, made tiltable and raised to the tiled roof, then lowered for healing. Be mindful of them as they stand and wait for the burn of the paid-out ropes to cool their slight light-headedness and incredulity to pass, those ones who had known him all along. I have to tell you that it gives me hope when I hear this poem in the maker's voice, that maybe our incredulity will pass, our light-headedness, our fears and doubts, our wonders over what happens next. The great gift of my other line of work is that it puts me in earshot of the A-game priests and pastors, rabbis and imams, poets and poobahs and perfect strangers bring to these horizontal mysteries at bedside, at boxside, at graveside. And I've been graced, I'd have to say, by my witness of the lifting and bearing and carrying that we all do for one another, paralyzed. Maybe the incredulity will pass. This language of shoulders and shovels and aching backs, waiting for the burn of paid-out ropes to cool, honors the hands-on whole-body habits of human labor the poet learned as a farm boy in Derry. I was reminded of it Christmas Eve in 2012 when Dennis O'Driscoll died. Dennis had been a friend for 25 years. He was Ireland's most bookish man, one of its under-celebrated poets, and Heaney's best biographer. They conspired on a book called Stepping Stones, and no doubt many of you know it, which is the nearest thing we will ever get to an autobiography of the Nobel laureate. And I had read that book back and forth from cover to cover several times before I found in its coda this question Dennis put to Seamus about Seamus going to Poland, to Krakow, when Czesław Miłosz, that unpronounceable Nobel laureate, died. And Heaney showed up in Krakow, and Dennis said, "Why did you go? Why did you make that trip?" And Heaney said, "Because he was a great poet who gave the art a noble profile, because I loved and was strengthened by his work, because I came to know him better personally in the years before his death, because I knew that when I got to Krakow, I'd be among friends who were friends of his, because going to funerals is so much a part of the culture that formed me, part of the ethic of respect. These sounded like words that I could say. It's why I got on the plane and flew to Dennis's burial in Nace a couple days hence, possibly because of the stroke that Heaney got in 2006 and the pig valve they installed in me in 2011. We took up the rear quarters of the cortege that made its slow way up the hill to St. Corbin's Cemetery in Nace, huffing and puffing on the steeper bits until we got to the side of the grave where they were lowering Dennis, much like a paralytic, through the roof of the world into the open ground of that new grave. And I was shocked again, some few months later, to get the word on a Friday morning at the end of August that Heaney is dead. That's what the text said. Heaney is dead. Ah, hell, I texted back. Ah, hell, indeed. The witness of Dennis's burial, the witness of Seamus's burial, drew in me a catch in the breath that I've still not let go of. They seemed to me like sacred spaces. They seemed as if my incredulity might pass, because though Heaney was, as they say in the north of Ireland, a Catholic agnostic. The question is, are you a Protestant or Catholic? Well, I'm an atheist, but yes, a Protestant or Catholic atheist. Heaney was a Catholic atheist. And I began to feel much the same way, that even though I find it impossible to account, I'm still borne along by the absolute beauty of the being of the church, of the faith, even when I cannot share it, even when it swings, as it often does, like a door both ways on its hinges. I also think that we have lost our way in this country in a way the Irish have not. They still shoulder their dead to the grave. They still open the grave themselves. They still close the grave themselves. That shovel and shoulder work is the minimum honor done to the dead who are transported among their own to the grave or the fire or the tomb that belongs to them. Here we don't do that so much. Here we are famous for the celebration of life, the sort of equivalent of a wedding without the bride and groom there, or a baptism without the baby. We have this notion that Calvary can be done without a cross, or Easter without a risen corpse. We have the idea of the thing, but not the thing itself. And maybe that's why churches have become so inhospitable to corpses. Not so much old Catholic churches, but as my colleague Dr. Long says, white, well-heeled, suburban Protestant churches, they don't see corpses much anymore. The memorial service has become that kind of invention where the finger food is good, the talk is uplifting, the music and message are all life-affirming. Someone's on hand to proclaim closure just before the Merlot runs out, and everyone's invited but the dead guy, who's been disappeared most days by someone like me, out of sight, out of mind, out of being with the rest of us. And it shows. We take reality TV for reality itself. And this crosses cultures and kinds, and it's making its way into Catholic thought, these gentrified, Disneyfied, routinized estrangement between the living and the dead. And the only ones who can change that is us. Heaney had this right as well when Dennis questioned him on the difference between a memorial service and a funeral. Memorial services are different from funerals, said Heaney, Funerals are closer to the bones, as it were. They have to deal with the rent in the fabric. They have to deal with what's been torn from us by returning it to us so that we can let it go again into whatever oblivion we decide to send it to. This weekend we will mark 15 years since among the great sadnesses and treacheries done to us was that our dead not only were killed, but they were disappeared. Their dying commingled with the terror that killed them. And funerals up and down the East Coast for thumbs or bones that were found sometimes months, sometimes years later in a parking structure or in some new excavation. And yet we speak of the bodies of the dead as if they were somehow just a shell, I think is the term we use, just a shell. But they are the shell we prayed over and worried over and put through school and took to the doctor and bedded with and bided with and had our suppers with. When Heaney's mother died, he wrote a series of sonnets called Clearances. I'll read the last of them because it describes, I think, the apostate poet's faith in what might be. I thought of walking round and round a space, utterly empty, utterly a source, where the decked chestnut tree had lost its place in the front hedge above the wallflowers. The white chips jumped and jumped and skited high. I heard the hatchet's differentiated, accurate cut, the crack and sigh and collapse of what luxuriated through the shock tips and wreckage of it all. Deep planted and long gone, my coeval chestnut from a jam jar in a hole, its heft and hush become a bright nowhere, a soul ramifying and forever silent, beyond silence listened for. Is that possibly what's there when we ask ourselves, as humans do and always have, what comes next? Why is it cold? Can it happen to me? Is that all there is? Those signature human questions that separate us from other living, breathing things. I don't know. Maybe that's the answer, a bright nowhere, a soul ramifying, branching out, rooting out, and forever silent, beyond silence, listening for. I'm going to finish now with a poem that I read on the way up in the hearse to take Seamus to his burial in Balahi. As Paul Muldoon said to me, "Well, do you need a ride?" I said, "I'm going in the hearse." He said, "Well," I just said, there's some advantage to knowing all the undertakers in the English-speaking world. And he says, "And there's an advantage to writing about them." So. But on the way up, as people gathered on the overpasses and came out of the shops and pubs and homes all along the way, holding their hearts and hats and offering their silent homages to the great poet going north to be buried in his home place, it was like nothing I'd ever seen before, like they said in Capernaum years ago when that man stood and walked. And I kept thinking, surely Seamus will stand and say it's all a great mistake. But he didn't. He went into the ground, the ropes paying out in the arms of his sons and nephews and brothers, the sod going back on top of him, and now all nicely curbed, a stone cut, the vigil being kept by writers and artists and poets, and will be years to come. He wrote a poem years ago called Funeral Rites, and I want to finish with this because I think it highlights those everyday miracles that we sometimes miss, the miracles of kindness and honor that we do one another when we get them where they need to go, or go the distance with them, even though they are gone, but not forgotten. even though they are still and paralytic and dead as mackerel. We go the distance with them. These are miracles. At the end of this, I think there's some questions and answers, and if you don't have any questions, then I have the hour and a half poetry reading just waiting for the right audience to spring it upon, and I can tell you, you do, so you might want to organize one or two, you know, stump the Undertaker questions. If I don't have the answer, I'll make something up, which is what writers do. My wife said to me years ago when we were having one of those contentious discussions, Tom, you've gotten to the age where you just make shit up. I started writing fiction the next day. And it's been ignored ever since. Funeral rites. And may I say thank you for not nodding off or breathing too heavily, because it's like going to the shrink and not getting a bill for it. I'm very grateful to you. Funeral rites. I shouldered a kind of manhood, stepping in to lift the coffins of dead relations. They had been laid out in tainted rooms, their eyelids glistening, their dough-white hands shackled in rosary beads, their puffed knuckles had unwrinkled, the nails were darkened, the wrists obediently sloped, the dulse brown shroud, the quilted satin cribs. I knelt courteously, admiring it all, as wax melted down and baned the candles, the flames hovering to the women, hovering behind me, and always in the corner, the coffin lid, its nail heads dressed with little gleaming crosses. Dear soapstone masks, kissing their igloo brows had to suffice before the nails were sunk and the black glacier of each funeral pushed away. I want you to think of that the next time you're stuck in traffic as a funeral passes by. Think of a black glacier changing the topography because of a death in the family of man. And congratulate yourself for your willingness to step in and take up your end of the box or the burden of whatever it is that accrues to the living in service of the dead. So, with that, I'll call it a day and hope there's a question or two. Thank you. I should say you can't offend me. I've raised teenagers and the damage is done, so you can ask anything at all. Embalm and write sonnets than anywhere in between that. Does anybody have anything at all? Yes, sir.
Do you have Haney's poem about the death of his brother?
Midterm Break, I think, is the name of that poem. I do have that poem.
Would you like to read that for us?
Yeah, let me see if I... that was in his first book, I think. Yeah, on page 11. Midterm Break. His brother had died at home. Heaney was coming back from boarding school. What age was he, Heaney? 15?
Yeah, he was.
Yeah. His brother had been hit by a car, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, we took his funeral cortege by Mossman, by his home. So we were in the road when this happened, taking Heaney back to Bellagio. I sat all morning in the college sick bay, counting bells, knelling classes to a close. At 2 o'clock, our neighbors drove me home. In the porch, I met my father crying. He had always taken funerals in his stride, and Big Jim Evans saying it was a hard blow. The baby cooed and laughed and rocked the pram. When I came in, and I was embarrassed by old men standing up to shake my hand and tell me they were sorry for my trouble. Whispers informed strangers I was the eldest away at school, as my mother held my hand in hers and coughed out angry, tearless sighs. At 10 o'clock, the ambulance arrived with the corpse, stanched and bandaged by the nurses. Next morning, I went up into the room,
Snowdrops and candles soothed the bedside. I saw him for the first time in 6 weeks, paler now, wearing a poppy bruise on his left temple. He lay in the 4-foot box as in his cot. No gaudy scars, the bumper knocked him clear. A 4-foot box, a foot for every year. There was such a humanity to country funerals in Ireland when my cousin Nora died. She was laid out in the bed she was born in, I suppose. And I certainly in the room she was born in. She was just south of 90, and her chin propped shut with a Dearly Missal, and the rosary tying up her hands as in the poem, and her little bird-like body tucked under the clean linens that a neighbor had brought, and the candles and the sick call kit, and the rosary humming through the little house, and the men out smoking in the yard and talking the prices of things until the box was brought, and they put her in. Actually, my brother Pat and I put her in because she had built a little extension on her house for the hot plate and the refrigerator, modern stuff, just like in America, she said, the same but different. So we had to take her out the back door, which was the only one big enough to get a box through. And the box was on little sawhorses, and we put her in. I have a picture of myself on the day, 25 years ago. But the civility of it, the decency of it, that men from that town then went out and dug her grave the night before, and then got there early to be sure the puddle that it always would be empty. I've been on that crew now many times since. You know, getting a grave ready for the 10 minutes the priest will have to spend there so that the groundwater hasn't come over the top of it. It is, as they say, near the banks of the River Shannon, where it's not so much dust to dust as mud to mud. This is how it happens. But we don't like to hear a splash when we lower our knee. It's just the owl decency. So we go with buckets and with hay bales and with quick dry cement and anything else we can to stanch the bleeding, as they say, until the priest comes for a dry grave and everybody goes home and the puddle refills and life goes on. And isn't that the worst of it, that life goes on? Here, of course, we hide all that. We go to the chapel, if we go at all. Mostly we don't. How many here have ever attended a cremation, actually attended the fire? Oh, goodness. And yet half of our dead are burned now, but no one goes. It has to do with our trouble with fire. Dante did that to us. We think of it as wasteful or punitive, and so we're all for cremation. More than half of us will be burned. But we're not in favor of the fire, even though those flame uraeuses over the heads of the apostles that first Pentecost, isn't that fire a gift? Isn't that flame an illumination? And yet we still have it messed up, so we just don't go. Just cremate me, we tell our children, and the operative word is just. We're not that fond of fire. And if we were, we'd go and watch. It's a holy space. And when the priest goes, which is never or seldom, he makes it even more holy by the rubrics of the church that are brought to such events. So for those of you who are practicing, practice that. Go the distance with the dead. It's honorable and human. Anything else?
There's been much reflection throughout history, and certainly sort of in literary theory about the relationship sort of between death and the sacred, or death and language, and so forth. The way in which you've spoken is that it's not quite as abstract as that. And it's not just simply the story of your life or the story of your grandfather. It is that certain ways in which we deal with the dead tell us or reflect something about literature or a particular form of literature or particular commitments of literature. It seems very important to you, not so much that you're an undertaker, but you're an undertaker sort of with bodies that you sort of have to dignify, bodies which you have to touch, bodies sort of near which you have to put in the grave, bodies which have bones. It seems that that commitment to death, that is, that the end of life is the end of an embodied person who should remain embodied, that tends then sort of to, in terms of your selection of Heaney, Heaney is that kind of poet who deals with the dead in that kind of way, or doesn't question sort of the dead in that way, who then writes about the dead in this embodied way, and extends that embodiedness sort of to a kind of form of humanism, giving voice sort of to the life between birth and death. Is that your commitment too in your poetry? To that sort of kind of embodied humanism that you dignify the life sort of in which we always have to remember as embodied?
One of the things I heard at Emory among these young seminarians trying to learn homiletics and wanting to change, mostly Methodist but some Presbyterian and Baptist life, they talked about a cloud of witnesses. And I sometimes feel as if around the dead, well, it has to do with the Irish habit of keeping the dead in the present tense. So Nora Lynch, may her memory be eternal, but chances are it won't be. At least is eternal at least 25 years, because anytime a good night is had or a sadness is had, her name will come up. Ah, she would have loved a night like this. Nora Lynch had that song better than the rest. And Tommy, her brother, a pure St. Francis of a man. So the dead are still alive in the common talk and the common traffic of that particular townland where they, you know, they lived without the trappings of their century, really. And I think that embodiment, invoking their name, is important. It's one of the things I find moving about the anniversary of 9/11 is that they read names. You know, you name the hurt. So I just think of incarnation as an important, I think it is the sort of one-up the Catholics have. We are into the bodies and blood part. And but it replicates what I see to be the human predicament. I remember being at a convention of funeral directors, say it isn't so. I was at a convention of funeral directors one time and the motivational speaker, whoever was up front, was saying, so what's the sort of essential, necessary, what do people call you, what's the problem they're calling you about? And one guy was saying, well, you know, they're trying to work through the five stages of grief, or, you know, they want someone to share the bar bill, whatever. And I remember whispering to the guy next to me, the corpse on the floor. That's the trouble. And you can try this at home. You can live with, and I tell this to my parish priest, a dear friend of mine, who says, why do they call you first? And I say, well, you know, I answer the phone, for starters. And we can dispatch someone right away. But the other thing is the true fact of the matter that we can live with a shaken faith. And we can live with a broken heart. You see people doing it with grace and dignity every day. But we can't live with a corpse on the floor. Try this at home. And we are, I think, the only species is that has an articulation and a way of doing this. Because, you know, cocker spaniels and rock bass and rhododendrons die. But, I mean, if you have goldfish, kill one tonight and see what the others do. I mean, basically, they have that look on their face like, more food for me. It's not the same for humans. We stop and wonder. And oftentimes, the wondering is done at the brink of the grave or the fire or the tomb or the tree or the sea or whatever oblivion we're casting our wonders and hopes into, and we say things like, is that all there is? This is the basic question, isn't it? And if, you know, if Christ had decided to do Good Friday, like phone it in, or if he'd raised his, say, personality trouble from the dead. We wouldn't be going to church, those that do. And so he raised his body from the dead. That was sort of a, well, that really got people angry when he did it to Lazarus. I mean, there's a theory that says that's exactly why they crucified him. That's a step, that's crossing the Rubicon. You can make the blind see, you can feed the hungry, you can make the paralytic walk. There were plenty of healers and mumbo-jumbo artists around that time and that place. But making corpses live, that's big medicine. So, yeah, the incarnate is very important, I think, to us. I don't say this for me, but I do like to remind us that when we estrange ourselves from our dead, we are estranging ourselves from humanity 101. And if we wonder why we're not sort of catching on to what's next, that might be the reason. I used to tell my Episcopal friends, who were sort of the cutting edge of the memorial service back in the 60s, because they had read Jessica Mitford, as I did, I used to say, as soon as the church becomes inhospitable to a corpse, you can watch the living leave. Now, 50 years hence, what has happened? But it's happened in all of our churches, mostly because the dead are no longer, they're talked about like Hallmark cards, Hence the celebration of life. When Joe Biden's son died, did you happen to see that funeral? He didn't get the memo about the celebration of life. That man was desolate. His heart was broken. He was done entirely unto by the death out of line of his son. And it showed. And everything, including the church, rose to that occasion. I think we should all be as lucky, but it begins with a willingness to play in that into the pool, which we are no longer culturally, religiously, or eschatologically prepared to do. We simply do not believe like we once did. We have lost, as Tom Long says, our eschatological nerve. So except for a little nostalgia, we don't actually have hopes. I do. I feel happily haunted, I must say. And it's what convinces me that those days that I believe in a loving God are good days. Because I do get glimpses of that, of those miracles. I see mothers of children dead of nothing, infant death syndrome. Take that home and talk about it. There's nothing to hold on to. But I've seen those women walk upright and speak in sentences and give thanks. So that makes me think whomever's in charge here is on the case. But there's plenty of evidence for the days that she takes off, or he does. So let me finish with one last poem of my own. I tried to write on my birthday every year a sonnet, because there are only 14 lines, Figured it was an easy job. It'd be done before noon. And it would remind me of the fact that I'm an internationally unheard of poet. But that I am a poet nonetheless. And so I wrote this poem out. I thought it was marvelous. I was 52 at the time, so it was a good few years ago now. But I was trying to see into the future, as people in their 50s do. And when I was done, I counted the lines. There were 15 lines, and I thought, that proves the point that the older we get, the less we count, So, and it also presented a good title, which was, and thanks for that compliment about titles, here's a good one, Refusing at 52 to Write Sonnets. It came to him that he could nearly count how many Octobers he had left to him, in increments of 10, or say 11, thus 63, 74, 85. He couldn't see himself at 96. Humanity's advances, notwithstanding in health care, self-help, or New Age regimens, what with his habits and family history. The end, he thought, is nearer than you think. The future, thus confined to its contingencies. The present moment opens like a gift. The balding month, the gray week, the blue morning, the hours, routine, the minutes, passing glance, all seem like godsends now. And what to make of this? At the end, the word that comes to us is, thanks. Thanks.